very good morning to all of you. So today we are going to talk about the kinetic isotopic effect, or primarily the secondary kinetic isotopic effect. So the first part of this video I have already discussed, and I'll give you the link over here. If you haven't watched it, please go ahead and watch it. Now when we talk about the second part, this is going to be highly conceptual, very important, and you will not find it in many books, I can guarantee you that. I'm not sure whether it will be very, very relevant to the entrance examination, but this is something which is conceptually very important, and it's in general very useful to understand. Now when I talk about the kinetic isotopic effect, which we have discussed about the deuterium primary kinetic isotopic effect. So there are two kinds of kinetic isotopic effects. One is primary and the other one is secondary. Primary we have discussed in the previous video, secondary we are going to discuss over here. One thing that I wanted to tell you, that why do we call it as deuterium kinetic isotopic effect? Because in this we are taking the isotope as deuterium. Okay, we can take the isotope as 12C and 13C also, but you know that the change in the atomic mass when we go from hydrogen to deuterium is almost double, right? Whereas if we go from 12C to 13C, or for any other atom for that matter, the difference will be very, very negligible. So when we measure the KH upon KD values, that is the rate constant of a reaction when a hydrogen is there, and the rate constant of the reaction when deuterium is there, there will be a significant change. So experimentally it will be very convenient to measure this. Whereas if we try to measure K of 12C upon 13C, rate of the reaction of these particular isotopes, maybe it might not be, the difference might not be that huge. That is why we generally consider KH upon KD, and that is why it is specifically called as deuterium kinetic isotopic effect. Now what exactly is a secondary kinetic isotopic effect? And there is something called as reverse kinetic isotopic effect. Okay, reverse means, I had told you in the previous video that in that case KH upon KD generally is considered to be greater than 1, but when I talk about reverse kinetic isotopic effect, it becomes less than 1, and this is very interesting. When you talk about secondary kinetic isotopic effect, in secondary kinetic isotopic effect, the carbon hydrogen bond, or any the hydrogen bond, basically in primary kinetic isotopic effect, like we had discussed in the last video, the breaking of the CH bond was a factor that we had to consider. But in secondary isotopic effect, that is something that we don't consider. That is why it is called secondary isotopic effect. That means the CH or a CD bond might influence the rate of the reaction, but it is not directly involved in the reaction. For example, if I have this carbon, and then or I'll just write CH and R2 over there, okay, just for convenience, I'll write CH, R2, we have a carbon and we have a good leaving group, okay, I'm not completing the valency over here, just for convenience. So now this carbon over here, there's a good leaving group attached, and this group leaves over here. Basically it's a nucleophilic substitution, the nucleophile will come and attack this carbon and the group will leave. For the tangling itself, carbocation is generated. So once the carbocation is generated over here, this will be one. Let's say this is one particular molecule that we have, and another molecule that we can have is which is substituted with deuterium. Now we need to determine which reaction will be faster. So the nucleophile basically will ultimately attack this carbon. We will not talk about the competing reaction, the elimination reaction we are not talking about. We are simply talking about nucleophilic substitution, right? And over here the nucleophile is going to attack. So now which reaction will be faster? The reaction that will be faster is where the carbocation will be more stable, because all of you know that when the carbocation is generated, that is mostly the rate determining step. So over here, whichever carbocation is more stable, that reaction will be faster. Now how does deuterium and hydrogen influence this carbocation? That is because of the hyperconjugation effect. See, I told you that the CH bond is much more labile and much more easily to break as compared to carbon deuterium bond. And generally we kind of like relate hyperconjugation to bond breaking, like this bond breaks and these electrons migrate. So like in a very trivial sense, we correlate bond breaking to hyperconjugation effect, right? So since this bond is easier to break, so this CH bond has having a greater hyperconjugation effect as compared to the carbon deuterium bond. So when you do the reaction, when you replace these hydrogens with deuterium, this reaction, this nucleophilic substitution, will go faster for hydrogen as compared to deuterium. So when you measure the KH upon KD values for this particular reaction, it will come out to be greater than 1. And this is called as the beta secondary kinetic isotopic effect. Why is it called beta? Because this is the carbon at which all the action is happening. So this is the alpha carbon and this is the beta carbon. So this hydrogen or deuterium presence at the beta carbon is influencing the rate of the reaction. That is why it is called secondary kinetic isotopic effect. And one more important part is that in primary kinetic isotopic effect, it is directly involved with the breaking or making of the CH bond. Generally breaking of the CH bond. But in secondary kinetic isotopic effect, there is no involvement of the CH bond directly in the reaction. Okay, there is no breaking of the CH or the CD bond. So that is why it is called secondary kinetic isotopic effect. Now the more important part over here, that what is this reverse kinetic isotopic effect? And I will explain that with the help of alpha secondary kinetic isotopic effect, right? Like this was beta secondary kinetic isotopic effect. Now let's talk about alpha. So in alpha what happens? Let's take this carbon. This is another carbon, okay? And let me take this example. Over here, instead of hydrogen, I will replace it with deuterium. Now, the same thing I do, the leaving group over here eliminates. Okay, so this X group will eliminate and a carbocation will be generated. This carbocation will be generated. Once this carbocation is generated over here, then what happens? Then again, we will have some nucleophile. That nucleophile will come and attack this carbon. So now the presence of CH bond over here or CD bond over here, how will it influence this particular stabilization of this carbocation? Now this is very, very interesting. This is very interesting and you need to see over here very carefully. This actually has to do with the activation complex. It might get a little complicated over here, so I want your full attention. Now we are talking about the activated complex. Over here, you know, secondary kinetic isotopic effect, the beta secondary kinetic isotopic effect and the primary kinetic isotopic effect could be easily explained with simple examples. But over here we really need to go into the reaction coordinate diagram and see the activated complex in order to understand better. Because when we go from sp3 carbon, now you can see this hydrogen is attached to the alpha carbon, that is where the reaction is happening. It itself is not participating in the reaction, but it's influencing the reaction over here, and this is the alpha carbon. So that is why this is called the alpha secondary kinetic isotopic, alpha secondary kinetic isotopic effect, right? The one we studied before was beta secondary kinetic isotopic effect, right? So when you go from sp3 to sp2, please remember this, the kH by kD value is generally seen to be around 1.2 to 1.3. Okay, 1.2 to 1.3. But when we go the opposite way, that is when we go from sp2 to sp3, surprisingly the value of kH by kD comes out to be 0.8 to 0.9. So this is your reverse kinetic isotopic effect. That means that the bond with deuterium is there. The rate of the reaction is faster when we have deuterium. Now this is very, very interesting and this is what we are going to talk about. It requires some kind of attention, so please, I want your careful attention over here. So if I talk about the reaction coordinate diagram, let's say, you know, here we have the progress of the reaction and here we have the energy. Okay, I won't write it down. On the y-axis we have the energy and on the x-axis we have the progress of the reaction. So when I talk about, now I will be talking about change from sp3 to sp2. For the timing, I will be talking about the change from sp3 to sp2. Okay, so let me just draw the coordinate diagram over here. This is, let's say, for hydrogen. This is for deuterium. And then we have the transition state over here for like this. This is how the reaction coordinate diagram will be. Okay. And over here we'll have hydrogen and deuterium. See, deuterium will always be lower in energy because I told you its vibrations are smaller as compared to hydrogen, right? A CD bond vibration will always be smaller in value or lower in energy. Okay, so it will always be lower in energy, but the magnitude varies, and that is where this reverse kinetic isotopic effect comes into the picture. The magnitude of this particular energy difference varies. Okay. Almost on the same level. So now deuterium will always be lower in energy. This is the transition state. Okay, this is the transition state or the activated complex over here. Because generally there is no direct breaking, right? There will be activated complex being formed. Now, when we talk about non-linear compounds or bent compounds, for example, over here, if you talk about a bent compound. So, in bent compound, what happens is that, and since the CH and CD bond breaking is not involved, so the atomic mass of deuterium or hydrogen does not play a bigger role over here. When we are talking about primary kinetic isotopy effect, the CH bond or the CD bond, the energy played a big role and so did the atomic mass. Okay, because deuterium had double the atomic mass. But over here, since we are not talking about breaking of CH and CD bond over here, the atomic mass does not have a bigger role to play, but the vibrations have a bigger role to play, right? Have a much bigger role to play. Now, if you talk about this complex, these are bent complexes. Okay, we have linear complexes, we have bent complexes. So in bent complexes, what happens is the bending vibrations play a greater role. Now this is something very interesting. So when you talk about bending vibrations for carbon, so let's say we have some substituents X1, X2, X3, and hydrogen. So this CH bond can bend in two ways. One is in plane bending and one is out of plane bending. Either it can bend in one particular plane only, that means in the plane of the bond only, or it can do out of plane bending. Okay, there are two bending modes. But when we talk about the sp2 carbon, in the sp2 carbon, what happens is the in plane bending still takes place easily. That means bending in the plane of the green board. But out of plane bending is not very easy because this carbon is planar nature. Or whenever it basically attains the sp2 character, the out of plane bending is not that great. So in this case, in plane bending is also easily possible, and out of plane bending is also easily possible. Over here, in plane bending is possible, but out of plane bending is very very less because this structure becomes rigid. So all you need to know is that when we go from sp3 to sp2, in sp2 the out of plane bending is very low in magnitude. Okay, the stretching frequency, the bending vibrations, the bending frequency is very very less. I think I don't remember the exact value, but the out of plane bending for sp3 is around 1300 centimeter inverse, and this is around 830 centimeter inverse. These are the roughly the values for the out of plane bending. This happens around 1300, this happens around 830, and the in plane bending remains the same. Okay, in plane bending over here and the in plane bending over here remains the same. So what does that lead to? What is the difference? So when we go from a sp3 carbon, there is a transition state, and then we reach the sp2 carbon. Now what did I tell you? That in a sp2 carbon, the bending vibrations are less frequent, or they are lesser in, like, the bending vibrations are less frequent. So when we talk about the difference between hydrogen and deuterium, when they have the sp2 nature, because their vibrations, because the out of plane vibrations are very very small, like it's around 830 centimeter inverse, so the energy gap between deuterium and hydrogen bendings are also very less. That's why you will see that the stretching frequency between carbon deuterium bond and carbon hydrogen bond is the most, and because the stretching frequency difference is a lot, I mean the value, the magnitude of the carbon hydrogen stretching frequency is 3000 centimeter inverse, and the magnitude of carbon deuterium stretching frequency is 2200 centimeter inverse, right? So the magnitude is a lot. Because of the high magnitude, the difference between the energies of a CH stretching and a CD stretching is very very large. But when you talk about bending modes, now because the bending mode is only 830 centimeter inverse, the difference in energy in a sp2 carbon between them is very very less. Whereas in the sp3 carbon, the difference is very very high. Please, I remember this point, this is the crux of the matter. When we talk about sp2 hybridized carbon, the magnitude of energy difference between the CH modes and the CD mode is very very high. But when we talk about the CH and CD bond in the sp3 carbon, because its value is 1300 centimeter inverse, the energy gap is more. If I talk about the stretching frequency, like I said, the CH stretching frequency is at 3000 centimeter inverse. The CD stretching is at 2200 centimeter inverse. So that magnitude is even greater. But like I said, we are talking about bent structures. So we are not talking about the stretching frequencies. We are specifically talking about the bending modes, not the stretching mode. We are talking about the bending mode, and even in the bending mode, you can say this diagram is for the out of plane bending. Okay, because in plane bending values remain the same. So again, the energy difference between a sp3 and sp2 will not be much. Okay, that value will not be much. But over here, because of this reduction in the stretching frequency, in the bending frequency or the bending mode, we have seen that we have less energy in sp2 carbon as compared to sp3. In sp3 is free movement, in sp2 the movement is restricted. This is the prime reason why we have the reverse kinetic isotopic effect. So now what we happens is, when you go from sp3 to sp2, like I said, we obtain the normal kinetic isotopic effect, because the energy required will be, this hydrogen will go from here to here and this deuterium will go from here to here. Okay, so you can see this is the case, this is the scenario. Now there is a large gap over here between deuterium and hydrogen, and there is a large gap over here also between the hydrogen and deuterium in the transition state. So what will happen? Basically, you can see the difference will remain almost the same, and the kinetic isotopic effect will be observed, because over here also there is a lot of gap, over here also there is a lot of gap between hydrogen and deuterium. But when we go over here, now if you observe that deuterium is absorbing this much energy and hydrogen is absorbing much more energy. See the gap over here and the gap over here. So even though hydrogen is a little higher in energy as compared to deuterium, but if you see, deuterium ends up absorbing less energy as compared to hydrogen. Hydrogen has to absorb much more energy even though it is higher in the energy level diagram. So, technically, if this level was same, over here, say hydrogen and deuterium both lie at the same level, then according to that, this deuterium should have, basically, this hydrogen should have absorbed less energy. Okay, you can see over here. Had they been on the same level, then hydrogen has to absorb less energy because it is higher in the energy level. But over here, deuterium had to absorb more energy. But since the reaction coordinate diagram or the activated complex, when you talk about in the activated complex, the deuterium comes over here and the hydrogen comes over here, that is generally the trend. Okay, that is this will remain fixed. Only the level of the energy is changing over here and over here. The level of energy is changing. Now over here, the level of the gap between both is very, very high. This is the sp3 carbon. Okay, this is the sp3 carbon. So the gap in the bending mode, the out of plane bending, is very, very high in sp3. But when you go from sp3 to sp2, now the gap decreases because of the reason I just explained. Because of this, what happens is, now this deuterium has to absorb less energy and the hydrogen in fact has to absorb more energy. That is why when you go from sp2 hybridized carbon to sp3 hybridized carbon, we obtain a reverse kinetic isotopic effect. The kH by kD value comes out to be roughly equal to 0.94 or sometimes 0.8 also. So if I talk about one common reaction, if you talk about these are the reactions, this is very, very interesting. So, and we are doing the reaction with this line of sight. We observe that this reaction happens, if this reaction happens at 1.0, this reaction happens at 0.94, the difference in the rate of the reaction. Okay. So this is the consequence of your kinetic isotopic effect, or more precisely, alpha deuterium secondary kinetic isotopic effect. This is the consequence of alpha deuterium secondary kinetic isotopic effect. Alright. So anyway, I hope you understood the concept well. One small example that I would want to take, electrophilic aromatic substitution. If you look into the mechanism, first the electrophile over here gets attached, and then there's this positive charge which is distributed or delocalized. And then the next step is basically abstraction of the proton. The conjugate base will abstract the proton and will lead to re-aromatization. So this is basically the electrophilic aromatic substitution. Now over here, what is the rate determining step? The rate determining step is not the abstraction of hydrogen, but the rate determining step is addition of the electrophile. So over here, the kH by kD values will be roughly equal to 1. That is, no kinetic isotopic effect will be observed for this particular electrophilic aromatic substitution. That's the nitration reaction. So this is also one way by which you can determine the rate of the reaction, or the mechanism of the reaction, I'm very sorry, right? And very recently, for the first time, this is actually in 2020, there's this research article that has been reported in Nature Communications, which is one of the topmost journals of chemistry. So over there, or science I would say, over there what they have reported is that a reverse kinetic isotopic effect, okay, a reverse kinetic isotopic effect for the first time with a value 0.3, this is amazing. This is splendid. And what reaction they have done? They have done this reaction, NH3 with xenon positive and ND3 with xenon positive. They did this reaction and they observed that this complex is going to be formed, NH3 xenon positive. Like, this is the complex that is going to be generated over here, ND3 xenon positive. This is the complex that is generated. I'll give you the link to the research article down in the description box. It is open access. That means anyone can freely read that article. So over there they have mentioned that this is more stable as compared to this. This ND3 over here is more stable. And the value, if you see this reaction, the value of KD is much, much faster as compared to KH, and the order is 0.3. Okay, this is for the first time. This low order has been reported for the first time. Why? What is the reason behind that? The reason that they have given is intramolecular vibrational motion. Okay, or intramolecular vibration resonance. So what they mean by intramolecular vibration resonance is to stabilize this bond. The energy needs to be dissipated among a different number of vibrational energy levels. Now if you compare the density of vibrational energy levels, now you have to relate it to physical chemistry. Okay, when you talk about vibration spectroscopy, in that you would have seen that the vibrational energy levels. So for deuterium, the vibrational energy levels are much, much closer or are much more dense as compared to hydrogen. So this energy can be easily spread among the different vibrational energy levels, and the density of vibrational energy levels is more in case of deuterium. So it is much more able to accommodate those extra vibrations or that extra instability due to the presence of extra or higher density of vibrational levels, because of which this complex becomes much more stable than this. I am telling you a very elementary and a very simpler understanding of the reason. If you are more interested, I'll give you the link in the description box. You can go ahead and watch that. Alright. So anyway, I hope you found this video really helpful. If you did, please like this video. I have put in a lot of effort to understand this concept and try to present it to you in the simplest way possible. Alright. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel, do subscribe to it. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next video very, very soon.